Okay, in verse 18. If the world hates you, keep in mind that it hated me first. If you belong to the world, it would love you as its own. You do not belong to the world, but I have chosen you out of the world. That is why the world hates you. Remember the words I have spoken to you. No servant is greater than his master. If they persecuted me, they will persecute you also. Okay?
Amen.
If they talked about me like a dog, they're going to talk about you like a dog. Okay?
That's right.
So don't expect, because you're a Christian, that people are going to treat you fairly and sweetly and you know, all of this, because it's not true.
Amen.
Because your spirit is uncomfortable to them from the beginning. Okay? When you step in the room, whatever spirit is in there that is not of God is uncomfortable with your presence.
That's right.
They don't know why they hate you.
Right.
But we are physical beings. We live in a spiritual environment. And the spirit may hate you and not really know why. But when I tell you, I just didn't like you. Why? I don't know. It's just something about you.
Yeah.
That I just didn't like.
Yeah.
And so, if the world hated Christ, it's going to hate you. Okay?
Amen.
So we have to expect that. Now, if you understand that and you expect that, you can deal with that person with a better understanding.
That's
you understand?
Right. That's right.
You can pray for that person. Okay? You can even go to that person that hates you and say, I know that you don't like me, but I just want you to know I'm praying for you. You don't even say, yeah, I know that you don't like me. I just want you to know I'm praying for you and your family and whatever. When you heap kindness on someone, you heap coals of fire on their head. And they can't figure out, you know, okay, I don't like you, but he's praying for me.
God.
So we have to understand this, okay? Verse 22. If I had not come and spoken to them, they would not. No, that's not where we were.
All right, 21, above 21.
Okay.
If they obey my teaching.
They will treat you this way because of my name, for they do not know the one who sent me. If I had not come and spoken to them, they would not be guilty of sin. Now, however, they have no excuse for their sin. He who hates me hates my Father as well. If I had not done among them what no one else did, they would not be guilty of sin. But now they have seen these miracles, yet they have hated both me and my Father. Okay. Well, I want to stick with that. That he hated both me and my Father. Okay. Now, why does Christ say, if they hate me, they hate my Father?
Because they're what?
Because if you've done it unto Christ, right? Then you've done it unto his Father, right? Is there another scripture that says that?
Yes.
Have you done to the least of them, you've also done it unto me. Okay? So, in the way that we treat other Christians, okay, if you've done it unto them, unto the least of them, you're doing this unto Christ. This is why I say we don't walk around judging people. Okay? Because the fact that we're supposed to love each other first has to remain in us no matter how mature we become in Christ. Okay? I have to be able to put up with my brother and to love my brother and to pray for him. Where am I at? 24? 24? If I had not done them, and no one else had done 25. But this is to fulfill what is written in the law. They hated me without reason. When the counselor comes, you know how you say counselor in Hebrew? Eliezer. Yeah, exactly. Can you, Atayokole Azorli? Azor Eliezer means, can you help me? It means helper, counselor. You have to see your Eliezer if you're in a Jewish university or high school. You have to go and see your Eliezer to talk about going to college. He's your helper, he's your counselor, right? So the counselor, it says, will come. He says, when the counselor comes, whom I will send to you from the Father, the Spirit of truth, he is, okay, who goes out from the Father, he will testify about me. Wow. And you also must testify for you have been with me from the beginning. Okay, now, when the counselor comes, okay, oh, I wanted to bring this paper that I got from Paris. They gave all the kids in school, I don't know if you guys got it at Poly, this pamphlet that says the power of the religion of Islam. And it says, and the subtitle says, the most interesting, the most misunderstood religion in the world. And then as I began to read, it talked about all the wonderful things of Islam and how they submit and they're beautiful people and all of this stuff. Okay. Now, these people say that the counselor is Muhammad. You understand? So I want you to understand, they believe the counselor is Muhammad. So now the counselor is Muhammad, the counselor has to uplift Christ. The counselor has to speak of Christ. You understand? So Muhammad never spoke of Christ. Okay? He spoke of Esau. Okay? Esau is the son of Isis. You understand? That's where they get Esau. But they say Christ was the son of Isis. Okay? So, now that's a long story about the Isis and birth of her son and Christ doing his mysterious years from 12 to 30 that nobody said anything. And then all of a sudden Christ appeared in India. And, you know, that's where they get this from, okay? From all of these writings from other people who said that they have a real Bible too, right?
Unrecorded information, huh?
Yeah. So, yeah, unrecorded information. These are the lost books of the Bible. And God's like, you know, I didn't lose the book. I didn't really, I don't know what they're talking about. There are no lost books, okay? Okay. But there is a son, is Esau. They think of Christ as the son, as Esau, who is the son of Isis. Okay? He's not Christ, the son of God. That's why they say God has no son, and Christ is not the Messiah. He's just the son of Esau who introduced this religion to the world. Okay? There is a lot of reasons why I study the way I do. Because you can make up a story, but you cannot change scripture if scripture is perfect.
That's right.
You understand? That's why when I'm trying to explain the scripture to you, I say, oh, a matter of fact, he put that in there 8 times because,
yeah, amen.
And a matter of fact, every 50th letter spells out Torah, but in this book, every 50th letter backwards spells out Torah, because you need to know that the author of this book did things that nobody else can do.
Amen.
You understand?
Amen.
So when you start getting writings and all of these things saying who Christ was and, oh, he married Mary Magdalene and all of this. This is where all this comes from. Esau, okay? This comes from the Islamic version of Christ who never died on the cross. Okay? that they put a replacement instead of him so that he wouldn't have to die because he was too good of a person. Which completely goes against Isaiah 53 that says the reason that he came is to save many. The reason that he died was to save many, okay? That he suffered to save many, okay? So, understand why I'm asking you as a body of Christ to study beyond the surface of the scriptures. Because the surface of the scriptures is really just a story until you find out that the author of the scripture is perfect.
Amen.
Okay? There's a reason why Jesus' name is 888. There's a reason why I can tell you about the coming of Christ in the book of Genesis and everything prophesied that he would do 3,000 years later, which actually happened. So if Genesis confirms Christ's life, that means this was not some second thought, okay? And there's nowhere in Genesis that it says Christ went off and for 13 years and went to India. Okay? And this is, I'm telling you guys the actual truth of what people believe from worldly teachings, okay? And if you don't know your Bible for yourself, okay? And not just know it, but know it to the point that I believe the Word of God because of what? Why? And this is my question. Why do you believe that the Word of God is true? Huh? Because it comes true. That's one good reason. Because the prophecies of the Bible come true. Okay? There's a scripture in the Bible that says that God will send ships against Ethiopia on the day that Egypt falls. The slave trade and the fall of Egypt started in the same year. Well, within 10 years of each other. Okay? So the Bible said that Egypt would fall and the slave trade would come to Cush, Black Africa, okay? So in history, it fulfilled what God said would happen.
Right.
In the book of Ezekiel, telling you what's going to happen, because God says specifically, I'm going to send ships against Ethiopia, against Cushites.
Wow.
Okay? So God has already rewritten history before it actually appeared. So now when we begin to read the scriptures that's giving us advice for our lives, we know that we're dealing with God and not religion. Because if it's religion, you have a choice rather to follow it and come under the light of it. Because this is not about being enlightened. You understand?
Amen.
This is about coming under obedience. You're not being enlightened, okay? You have to come under obedience. And this is why the scripture in 15 is letting you know that I am, it starts off like that. I am the true vine. I am God. This is how you're going to relate to me. This is how you're going to have a relationship to me. Everything that you do has to be connected to me. If you try to operate your life without me, you will be like a branch that is gotten away from the vine, and you will bear no fruit, and I will have to cut you off, and you will burn.
Amen.
But if you stay in me and you stay connected to my word, you can ask whatever you want and I will give it to you. You will live blessed. But if you become disconnected from me and say, I don't need to go to Bible study, I don't need to read my Bible for this week, then you're going to be disconnecting yourself from God. Okay?
Amen.
Okay, let's go on to verse chapter 16. Okay, it says, all this I have told you, so that you will not go astray. Okay.
My goodness.
The whole Bible just encouraging you to do what? Stay with me. Stay in my camp. Don't go astray. Don't go outside of this camp. Something could happen to you out there. You know what I mean? Stay in the camp, because in this camp you're connected to life. There's no other connection to life anywhere else in the world, okay?
Amen.
This is it, okay? There's one plug socket and it's God.
Amen.
You don't have any, if you don't plug into this, into Christ, uh-huh. into this word, you do not have life.
Amen.
Okay?
Amen.
It says, will not go astray. They will put you out of the synagogues. In fact, a time is coming when anyone who kills you will think he is offering a service to God. Then that time is coming. They will do such things because they have not known the Father or me. I have told you this so that when the time comes, you will remember that I warned you, and I did not tell you this at first because I was with you. Now I am going to him who sent me, yet none of you ask me, where are you going? Because I have said these things, you are filled with grief. But I tell you the truth, it is for your good that I am going away. Unless I go away, the counselor will not come to you. But if I go, okay, if I go, I will send Eleazar to you. You understand?
Amen.
I'm going to send the helper to you. When he comes, he will convict the world of what? What did your Bible say?
Of guilt,
okay, in regard to sin, and righteousness, and judgment in regard to sin. We're gonna stop in a minute.